Hey everybody, I'm Mike Giardina with CrossFit Health. We're at the Metabolic Health Summit here in Santa Barbara, California. And I'm super honored to be here with Dr. Satchin Panda. We're going to talk a little bit about circadian rhythms. Before that, Dr. Panda, can you please provide us maybe a little bit of a background on, you know, what you do, what your research is in, a little bit about what you're going to talk about at the Metabolic Health Summit, and we'll kind of dig into the circadian rhythm.
Yeah. So I'm a professor at the Salk Institute, and my work is on circadian rhythm, or the internal timetable that programs almost everything in our body. And so recently my work is mostly focused on how to improve human performance, because you know, irrespective of age, gender, ethnicity, or your performance level, everybody wants to be at their peak performance.
Sure.
And this is a universal human aspiration and human right.
Yeah.
And so the idea is, how can we combine the pillars of health, so that is exercise, nutrition, sleep, and stress management, to elevate our physical, emotional, and intellectual performance at any stage of life.
Amazing. So let's do this. To unpack that a little bit for the CrossFit community, let's define circadian rhythm. So what are we talking about when we say circadian rhythm?
Yeah, so we can kind of think of this as circadian rhythms are internal timetables that are present in every cell, in every organ, and in even in our brain. And these master plans essentially tell each of our 20,000 genes to turn on and off at the right time in the right organ. Okay. So for example, the circadian rhythms tells our brain when to wake up and when to sleep. And if that timing mechanism is broken, then you may stay awake all through the night and feel sleepy in the late afternoon. But the impact is more broader than that, because these internal timetables essentially help. These programs help to improve our immune function so that we are protected from many kind of diseases. Then it optimizes brain function so that we can be at our peak emotional and intellectual performance. And then it also supercharges our metabolism so that we can detoxify and use nutrient in the best way to build muscles, reduce fat mass, and reduce DNA damage. So overall, these programs are present in every organ, and they work together to keep us healthy in every hour of the 24 hours day. Because when you think of health, being healthy means having a good night of sleep, also feeling light and more energetic in the morning, and feeling emotionally charged for the first half of the day, and having enough energy to do CrossFit or any high intensity exercise, whatever you do, in the late afternoon. And also, healthy means you should be able to enjoy your end of the day, spend time with your family. So all of these are programmed by circadian rhythms.
Perfect. And you can see, I mean, with that explanation, I think most of people watching this can figure out at some point during the day that you just listed where things aren't very optimal for them, right? That's pretty. And let's talk about this, because you mentioned this a little bit in your introduction, but I know you talk about these, and I don't know if I'm describing this right, I'll just say six pillars that affect circadian rhythm. Is that right?
Yeah.
So can we go through those just a little bit?
I mean, these are the six pillars that actually we can practice, and that's the beauty of it, because, you know, when you think of this, when you hear this is the internal program that turns on and off 20,000 genes, it sounds very big.
How
do I do this? But so research from our lab and other labs, if we put them together, then we can come up with six simple habits, I would say, that can help to nurture our circadian rhythm.
Okay.
So rule number one is, try to go to bed at a consistent time and be in bed for 8 hours. We're not asking you to sleep for 8 hours. Be in bed for 8 hours.
Okay.
So you can get 7 hours of sleep, which is turning out to be at least the minimum sleep that we need. Then number two is, when we wake up, we have to wait for at least an hour or two before we have our first bite of the day, or fast calorie, because that's the time when our sleep hormones are coming down and our stress hormones, cortisol, are rising. And what we call, this is the changing of the guards in the morning. And our nutrition metabolism is not at its peak. So our digestive system is not ready. We're still waking up to digest food.
How does, as I'm sure you get asked this quite a bit, how does coffee play a role? So let's say you had black coffee, no calories in it, but it does have some, you know, physiological effects on the body. Will that take away from what you're talking about here?
Not necessarily, but what happens is you got to ask, why are you drinking coffee?
Yeah,
most people drink coffee because they didn't sleep enough.
Right.
And if you're drinking coffee to wake yourself up, then you got to ask, maybe I should go back and sleep enough and reduce my coffee intake. Actually, black coffee doesn't affect circadian rhythm as much, but there is also studies done showing even at single cell levels, coffee can reset our clock.
Interesting.
But the jury is still out.
Okay.
So then, rule number three is, after waiting for 1 or 2 hours, have your breakfast at a consistent time.
Okay.
Because the fast calorie of the day synchronizes all the clocks in our body. And when that synchronization signal comes, then that essentially telling the body, this is the start of your metabolic day.
Sure.
And what we are finding, and people have shown over the last 50 years of nutrition research, people who have random breakfast time, they actually don't perform at the peak level. So they are at a high risk for metabolic diseases. And then after you start your first breakfast, then the crux of the circadian rhythm now is try to eat within 8, 9, 10, or maximum 12 hours, which is, we discovered this almost 10 years ago, 2012 May actually, the same month, and which we call time-restricted eating, and now it's also popular as intermittent fasting. And there are many benefits of intermittent fasting. Even among athletes and resistance training athletes, what we're finding is it improves their performance slightly, but it also reduces their fat mass and reduces inflammation. And when you're thinking about being the difference between the silver medal and the gold medal, it's very tiny, and anything that you can squeeze out of a peak lifestyle, that helps. So then the fourth one is try to be outdoor for at least 30 minutes in the day, because the daylight actually synchronizes our brain clock, but light is also an antidepressant.
Okay.
It's plentiful and free, so one has to go out. And if you can do exercise outdoor, then that's much better.
Okay.
And then the fifth one is exercise, because we all know that exercise is medicine, and we still cannot explain all the benefits of exercise. It has multiple benefits. There are two things with exercise and circadian rhythm. One is, there is new discovery that actually your muscle regulates your sleep much more than any other organ.
Interesting.
Because when we have a healthy circadian clock in our muscle, then animals also get better sleep when they go to sleep. And we still don't understand the science, but it's just observation. Another thing about circadian rhythm and muscle or physical exercise is late afternoon seems to be the best time for physical exercise.
Late afternoon.
Late afternoon, early evening, not too late into the night.
Okay.
Because that's when your muscle, your joints and ligaments have warmed up enough, your muscle is at its peak activity, and also your repair function is much better. So, you know, when you're physically active, you're continuously repairing your body every single day, and that repair function is much better if you exercise in the late afternoon. In fact, if you go back to Olympics world records, disproportionately more number of Olympic records are set in late afternoon, evening than in the morning.
Wow.
And you can go in many different sports and you'll see there is this trend of circadian effect.
Interesting.
So then the last one is, in the evening, try to wind down, because eating your meal too close to bedtime is also not good, because your digestive system needs that winding time to give you a better night's sleep. And also dimming down light helps because light reduces our sleep hormone melatonin.
Okay.
And if you're exposed to bright light, for example, going to a drugstore or even getting your grocery at night, huge amount of light.
Yeah.
So these are the six things, like going good night of sleep, waiting in the morning for an hour or two, timeless eating, good exercise, at least 30 minutes of antidepressant light, and winding down.
And with that one, let's say the light one, does it really, I mean, obviously during sunlight hours, but is it better to do that, try to do that earlier in the day, or does it not really matter?
Well, the jury is still out.
Okay.
The point is, if you can get any amount of 30 minutes of daylight, and it doesn't have to be sunlight, that's the beauty.
Okay.
So for example, right now in sunny California, if you go outside, you'll get 100,000 lux of light.
Yeah.
But in this point, in this spot where we're sitting with enough light coming through, we must be getting 2,000 to 3,000 lux of light.
Oh, wow.
And that's enough. An hour of a couple of thousand lux of light is even better. So
Open the blinds. And get some sunlight in.
Even you can have your breakfast right next to the window. And
yeah.
If you're in a CrossFit studio, then just have the windows all open. And
yeah.
If you have glass wall, then that's even better.
Even better. Really cool. Another question I had regarding the end of the day and stopping your eating so you can wind down. What do you think in terms of that timeline? Is it 2 hours before bed, an hour and a half of bed? Is that kind of individual, like relative to the individual? How does that work?
Yeah, so that comes from recent research on the sleep hormone melatonin and its effect on insulin.
Okay.
So what people are finding is nearly half of us, we really don't know who are the half who and who are the other half. Nearly half of us will start producing melatonin 2 to 3 hours before our habitual bedtime. So that means if you're going to bed at 10 o'clock,
yeah.
then your melatonin production starts around 7 or 8 in the
okay.
evening. And melatonin, just like it makes our brain to sleep, it also makes our pancreas to sleep. So that means our pancreas cannot produce enough insulin right away.
Sure.
And you want that insulin to absorb that glucose, and also for people who are physically active to store that glucose as glycogen and not as fat late in the night. So that's why the rule of thumb is it's better to finish your last calorie 2 to 3 hours going to bed.
So just assume you're that 50%.
Yeah, because even if you are not that 50%, what happens is after your last calorie, although your mouth finished eating, your stomach actually digests your food for next 5 hours.
Uh-huh.
And okay. when your stomach is digesting food, that means all the blood circulation is going towards your digestive system to absorb the nutrient and take it out. So your core body temperature is high to help you with digestion.
Yeah.
And with high core body temperature, it's difficult to have a good night's sleep. So even if you take the melatonin portion away, just the physiology of digestion and how our core body temperature fluctuates will explain why we need to stop eating 2 to 3 hours before bedtime.
Perfect, perfect. So on the exercise, later in the day, early evening, probably at least maybe prior to your last meal.
Yeah,
ideally,
prior to your last meal. But you must understand, like you all have to keep in mind that exercise at any time
is beneficial. Yeah.
But if you're just competing for that,
if
you want to elevate your, crank it up a little bit more and reduce your risk for injury, that's very important because a lot of people have injury. So in that way, late afternoon exercise is much better.
Helps you optimize, reduce risk a bit for injury in any type of exercise. Last one, you talked about nutrition quite a bit here. When it comes to nutrition, is there any type of eating pattern that you've noticed that has a greater effect, positive effect, on circadian rhythm?
Well, the nutrition field is very difficult to navigate because one thing is we eat different meals on different days and we have different composition of meal and we cannot record that composition very well.
Yeah.
But what is becoming clear is when you are trying to fast overnight for 14 to 16 hours, then it's better to avoid simple, highly processed sugary snacks or drinks at your dinner time because that will get digested very quickly and then you'll feel hungry and you may not have that energy, high level of energy that you need in the morning.
Gotcha.
So the bottom line is have a much better balanced diet in the at your dinner time,
yep.
A good dose of protein, fat, and complex carb,
yep.
And that will help you to go through the overnight fasting and also helps you recover and rejuvenate your muscles that you need,
simple,
that you injure, yeah.
Non-processed,
yeah.
More whole foods. It'll allow you to be satisfied for longer periods of time,
yeah.
Through that, you know, non-eating window, essentially.
Yeah.
Awesome.
Great. Thank you.
This was great.